Well, hello and welcome to church. Welcome online. Welcome Hebron. Welcome Jail. And of course, welcome Demott Wheatfield. Glad to be back with you on this super cold Sunday. It was tough canceling last week. Minnesota, me, was like, oh, it's just fine. Come on, you guys. We just get on the snow machines and get to church, okay? If we got to ski, we got to ski, but we're going to get there, all right? And the leadership team was like, yeah, nah. I mean, can't get out of the garage. It's done. I was like, maybe you guys are right. So anyway, I'm super, super glad to be back together with you this week. You know, I mean, come on, guys. -8, no big deal. We would still have recess in Minnesota. You know, us kids there. Frostbite was like sunburn, you know, no big deal. But anyway, this next month we have 28 people going through the next step process in Hebron, which is super, super cool. We're so proud of what God is doing through you guys up there. And I know so many people here at Wheatfield have FOMO about what God is doing through you. And thank you for your faithfulness building a community up there. And I'm thankful to be a light of truth in both cities. And I'm really glad to be back in person with you. Like I said, we're kicking off a brand new series called Hindsight is 2020. Come on, oh my goodness. And I love that pun so much. I love puns. The older I get, the more dad I become. It's okay, though. I have kind of based this whole series off the concept that those who fail to learn from history are bound to repeat it. And I think that's such a big deal. A month out from what was a really eventful year, I wanted to take a little bit of time to reflect on what happened and maybe learn some lessons if we can. And I think this is going to be an important series. Obviously, next week we have the Valentine's Day thing. If you're single, married, dating, widowed, or divorced, I think you're going to love it. And you don't want to miss that. We're going to learn from the hindsight of relationships. But this week specifically, I want to talk about how to stand up for Christ in the midst of conflict. And what I'm going to do in this message, I'm going to introduce it with a story, then we're going to look at some Bible, and then we're going to end with some points. And at the end of this message, I want Christians and non-Christians to be able to stand up to people who really hate you. And I think that's a big deal today. It didn't used to be that you had people in your life who would really hate what you believe or like say it in such a just blunt way. But today, that is the case. And I want to talk about what to do when that happens in your life. And at 19 years ago, I had a spiritually defining church trip as a teenager. And parents, please send your kids on our youth trips. They're really, really big deals. They're more valuable than the entire year of student ministry combined. Our student leaders right now are on a gauntlet trip up in Wisconsin, and I hope you're praying for them. But this summer, we have two opportunities for your kids. We have movement camp, and we have gauntlet. And both of those experiences are truly amazing. Sign them up for it. Make it happen. Save for it. All of my spiritual pivotal moments came on youth trips. I can truly say, like, looking back at my life, for sure. And my parents would tell you today, they're so glad that they sent me on those deals because God really changed my life through them. But anyway, I remember going on this trip when I was 16. It was called the Challenge Conference. And 10,000 students descended on Georgia Tech University's campus in Atlanta, Georgia. And I still vividly remember the messages that I heard there. There was an up-and-coming worship singer who's kind of now old and gone, but his name was Chris Tomlin. And he led the worship for 4 days. And there was this other guy named Louis Giglio that opened up the entire experience. And I still remember all the points of his message. I can remember exactly what he said. And then this young Chinese man named Francis Chan also spoke for several of the sessions. And it was at that conference, hearing Francis Chan speak, that I decided I wanted to be a pastor. Literally that experience. Because I realized it wasn't about growth or crowds or lights. It was about the glory of God and God's grace filling our lives. And to this day, my parents will say those trips changed our son forever. So we were on this trip, and it was an incredible experience. And I know there were girls on that trip, but I don't remember the girls. It was just me and my closest guy friends hanging out. It was so much fun. And one afternoon towards the end of the trip, we were doing a service project at a train station. It was like some light rail transport train place, and we were like cleaning the windows. I don't remember what we were doing, but they sent us out, take a break this afternoon, clean some windows, talk about what God's doing, whatever. And things were going normal. We were all laughing at each other and with each other, just having a good time, giggling, whatever. And a plainclothes man comes up to us, and he puts a big handgun in my face. And he shouted at me to freeze. And I just remember thinking, wow, that's crazy. Like, what's happening? And I must have fit the description of someone they were looking for. And I'd had run-ins with the police where I get pulled over and have some issues like this. But never just standing there randomly with friends and all of a sudden there's a gun in your face. Please don't shoot up the place. And it's so interesting how a moment can be totally normal and then the next moment it's like not normal. You know how in the movies, like there's music, there's foreshadowing, it's like you know something's coming and then it happens. In real life, that's not how emergencies happen. It's just like everything's normal and then not normal. Everything's normal and then the guy you're standing next to has a heart attack. Everything's normal, and then you're in a car wreck. Everything's normal, and then there's a gun in your face. And I just remember thinking to myself, is this really happening right now? Like, I couldn't even compute, and I'd never seen a gun like that. I've identified it today. It wasn't like an M9 Beretta or anything like government issue. It was a Desert Eagle, which is a garishly huge gun. If you're familiar with guns, I mean, this thing is like the anime of guns. It's like super ridiculously big. And I just remember thinking, is he talking to me? Is he a police officer? Is he a bad guy? Is he both? Am I gonna get shot in the face right now? I remember thinking that. And I put my hands up and I said, don't shoot me. Don't shoot me. And everyone around me, some friends I had, they all ran away screaming. My youth pastor was like doing the Heisman on all the other kids to get out of there. He was like, get me out of here. Ah! You know, he's running away. And I'm just like, don't shoot me, right? And I don't blame him. You know, what are they going to do? But after some tense moments, you know, this guy's just standing there with a gun in my face. I don't know what he was thinking. He just puts his gun down and he walks away. And I was like, well, that was weird. And so we debriefed for a moment, but in classic 2002 fashion, we all just kind of silently agreed to not talk about it anymore. And we shoved all of our emotions into a little box, and we locked that box, and we threw that box into a volcano, and didn't talk about it ever again. And that was it. I mean, today, that would have been, traumatic. We would have called my parents. We would have ended the trip early. We would have all had counselors in the parking lot waiting for us. We would have talked about how I was a victim of racial profiling and blah, 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 blah. I mean, it would have been ridiculous. But that day, we all just moved forward. And it's interesting, I think God actually used that event to open up my heart to a call to ministry, because that was the night Francis Chan spoke and I said, I'm gonna be a pastor. And I'm sure it was that experience that made my heart open, like, you know, what if you die tonight? It's like, yeah, what if I die tonight? I mean, I thought I almost died on that train platform. That makes sense. And you know, it's so interesting, when you experience danger like that, you get that moment in your gut where you're like, ah, you know what I'm talking about? That moment, like everything's normal, and then, you ever have that? Like, I don't know what to do right now, you know? And that's what 2020 has felt like. A lot of moments like that. Just, looking back, it's not the pandemic that was scarring. It's the sudden, cruel, verbally violent confrontations that we've had with like friends throughout the pandemic. It's almost like we're being held at the gunpoint of culture. And I don't know if you've experienced this, but I have many times. It's like, submit to this opinion without being able to ask questions or I'll shoot our relationship. And it's like people are holding our relationship hostage. It's like, if you wear a mask, well then you are a traitor to the country and you're treasonous and you're giving freedom away and we can't be friends. It's like, wait, what? What are you saying? If you don't wear a mask, you're killing my grandma and I can't be friends with you. It's like, wait, what? hold on. Can we just talk for a moment? No, choose now. What? Ah, right? In your stomach? Or regarding politics, if you don't believe that all cops are racist, then you're racist and I can't be friends. Wait, what? Why are you? Why? What? What's happening? Don't shoot. If you don't embrace critical race theory, then you're a person of white privilege and you're racist and we can't be friends. It's like, okay. A lot of big words there. Don't even know what you're talking about, but I don't necessarily agree or disagree. Can you just put the gun down? Like, don't shoot. And I think that's what a lot of us felt like in 2020. Like, these things are happening and it's like, and we just froze. And your mind kind of does some gymnastics. For so many of us, 2020 felt like the train station did for me 19 years ago, where things were normal. And then all of a sudden, our life falls apart and there's a proverbial gun in your face and your gut drops. And I think some of us were just kind of trying to forget it, like, let's just move on. That was crazy. I mean, that happened, but, you know, let's just block it. Some of us are scarred from it and still processing. I think for me, most significantly, our faith in Christ is having some train station moments. I've shared with you guys a lot, you know, my atheist uncle used to confront me at Christmas time, and it felt just like those moments at the train station where, like, yeah, I mean, if you're a Christian, you're a bigot and you're part of this hurtful movement and da-da-da-da-da, do you believe those things? And I'd be like, right? I don't know. I mean, oh my gosh, that's scary, right? And I'd freeze and I'd panic and my gut would drop. I think the big, big question today is what do you do when someone points a cultural or religious gun at you? What do you do? It's like the relationship's on the line and whatever. And they're like, if you don't agree with me, I'll unfriend you. Huh? Only terrible people believe this thing that you're likely to believe. Do you believe that terrible thing? And it's like, I mean, you know that I do though. You know, like what are we supposed to do here? How do you respond in moments like that? And I think somewhere along the line, I've wondered if Christians didn't invent an 11th commandment. I don't know if you guys have heard of the 10 commandments, but it's a list of rules in the Old Testament. You know, and Jesus replaced them with one new commandment, love one another in the same way that I've loved you. That's the new commandment. But anyway, I kind of, you know, making a pun, feel like Christians have made an 11th commandment, which says, be nice and don't do anything that would make people leave the church or be hurt. Just be nice. Just be nice. And it's almost as though Christians have reached this place where anybody who disagrees, it's like, okay, take whatever you want. It's fine. We don't want to fight. You know what I mean? Just whatever. Like, accept my new doctrine or I'll destroy this place. It's like, okay, maybe you should be an elder then. That's great, you know? Accept my new doctrine on the universal Christ or I'll call you a hate-filled bigot. Do it now. Wait, okay, you know, whatever. If you want it, that's fine. And we, instead of like evaluating, instead of dialoguing, instead of having discourse, it's like we feel like we're being held up at gunpoint. And we just want to shut down and pretend like it's not happening. The problem is, and here's the problem, is it is happening. And we're letting the tail wag the dog. We take Jesus out of context. We say, well, just turn the other cheek. Just turn the other cheek, John. I mean, why can't you just turn the other cheek? And that's not at all what is taught to the church. Yes, Paul teaches us to be all things to all people. Christians aren't supposed to be abrasive, you know, holding a megaphone saying like, you know, turn to Jesus or go to hell, you know, or whatever. That's not what we're supposed to do. But at the same time, we don't just let people come in and change the gospel of Christ. I want to read to you some passages of scripture. And this is, you know, the Bible speaking, not me, but Peter, the assistant disciple to Jesus, probably the second in command of Jesus' disciples, said, stay alert, watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And I remember reading that as a kid thinking, yeah, that's what it feels like Satan wants to do. He wants to devour my faith. And some of you, you've been experiencing that. The last couple months, the last year, hindsight of 2020, it's like, yeah, I mean, Satan has definitely been attempting to devour and destroy and eat my faith. And what does he say? Does he say, well, just let it happen and be nice? No, he says, stand firm against him. Be strong, be courageous, be steadfast in your faith. And I want to look at you and ask you, are you standing firm? Are you being strong and courageous? Daring and steadfast. Acts 4:18 talks about how the disciples have been arrested without a trial. Unreasonably, they've been beaten and imprisoned without a trial. And eventually they get called in front of Congress and it says, so they called the apostles back in and they commanded them never to speak again or teach in the name of Jesus. And they said, yeah, Jesus is kind of problematic for us. We think he's kind of exclusive and intolerant. And he's too liberal. He's socialist. We don't like Jesus and we don't want him. And so don't speak in him. And I like what they respond in verse 19. They say, okay, whatever you say then. No. It says, but Peter and John replied, do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop telling about everything we have seen and heard. We can't unseen what we've seen. We have seen Jesus be risen from the grave. We can't not talk about it. And notice they're still respectful of the authorities. They submit to the jailings and the beatings. It's not about that. And they separate a personal preference from a spiritual standard. They're not sitting here defying a mask mandate, okay? They're defying a mandate to sin by ignoring the Great Commission. There is a time and a place for civil disobedience as a Christian. I want to be clear. God does put the authorities over us, and there is a time and a place for civil disobedience. In Jude 3, he goes on. Jude says, dear friends, I had been eagerly planning to write to you about the salvation that we all share. I've been planning to just preach the gospel of Jesus to you. You know, Pastor, why can't you just preach the gospel? Well, Jude's like, well, I wanted to preach the gospel that we all share, but now I find I must write about something else, urging you to defend, not just sit back and say nothing, to defend the faith that God has entrusted once for all time. And I like that phrase, once for all time. It doesn't change. If somebody comes and says, hey, you know what, the gospel of Jesus, I found this new book, I found this new doctrine, I found this new ideology, and you know, it kind of changes and I've discovered in the way this, and he's like, no, it doesn't change. I mean, we have the record of the early church fathers. We know. We have a really, really good historical record of our theology. It doesn't change. It's once for all time to his holy people. I say this because some ungodly people have wormed, and that's an interesting adjective that he chooses there, wormed their way into your churches, saying that God's marvelous grace allows us to live immoral lives. Just do whatever you want. I mean, if you were born with that desire, just indulge it. You know, I mean, you just do you. You just do you. You just have you. You just be happy with you. He says, that's wrong. The condemnation of such people was recorded long ago, for they have denied our only master and Lord, Jesus Christ. So interesting to hear this description. I feel like as I read the New Testament again this spring, I relate to it on a different level than I have before. In the hindsight of 2020, man, I see the story and the plight of the apostles, and I feel it in my own life. And I don't know if you have too, but it feels like almost as though we're standing before the sword, standing before the gun of society saying, agree or be destroyed. I like what Paul says. Actually, I don't like what Paul says, but I'm inspired by his tone, his courage, his bravery, and his steadfast wisdom here. In Galatians 1 and verse 6, it says, I am shocked that you're turning away so soon from God who called you to himself through the loving mercy of Christ. You're following a different way that pretends to be the good news, but is not the good news at all. You're being fooled by those who deliberately twist the truth concerning Christ. So in the early church, they had these people who were choosing to follow Jesus. And then some people came in and they twisted the truth. They said, hey, you know, really, you're not a sinner and you can kind of do whatever you want and whatever. And this idea that we need grace, I mean, it kind of sounds problematic and exclusive. And they deliberately, and it's so relatable, isn't it? Now, Paul's response is harsh. And I got to be honest, I read it, and I think, man, that sounds mean. And yet this is the example that we have. This is what he says. It says, let God's curse fall on anyone, including us or even an angel from heaven who preaches a different kind of good news than the one we preach to you. So if I, the pastor of this church, start preaching a different kind of good news, let God's curse fall on me. Like, don't listen to me. I want to be clear here. It's been the same. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Even an angel from heaven. Wow. He goes, let me say it again. What I said before, in case you missed it, if anyone preaches any other good news than the one you welcomed, let that person be cursed. So when it comes to false teaching, you know, this concept of just be nice. Well, Paul isn't gentle. Jude is not gentle. Jesus is not gentle. The apostles are not gentle. John the Baptist called people who taught heresy a brood of vipers, which in its context was kind of PG-13 language. I have to tell my kids all the time, would you stop calling each other a brood of vipers? I'm gonna have to put dish soap in your mouth to keep doing that, okay? Do you want that? No, just kidding. That's not language they use. Wouldn't be that harsh in my house. Anyway, the notion that Christians are to simply allow false teachers to kind of do their thing and maybe we could just, you know, walk together in unity and to be nice and keep the peace. That's not true. And I think the problem is a lot of us don't know how to respond. You're like me on that train platform. Everything was, you know, pretty normal. I mean, yes, you know, you watched the news or you thought back to college or you saw your kids going to school and they come back and say things, but generally things were normal. And then all of a sudden it's like, what? Wait, what's happening right now? Because it happens like that. You're being held by relatives at relational gunpoint. You know, you're at a barbecue this summer and it's your first time getting together in a while. And all of a sudden your relative's like, agree with me, our relationship dies. And it's like, really? Like we don't, okay. And this is right now, one shot, one opportunity. Like, can we slow down? No, I can't be friends with an, and it's like, wait, what? This feels like relational terrorism, doesn't it? A little bit. And the problem, here's the problem. 99% of our lives are normal. We're here in DeMott Wheatfield and Hebron. And what I love about our community is, I mean, we really get it. Democrats, Republicans, we're friends, right? We understand that politics can't save us. Politics aren't our Lord and Savior. And I love that the Church of Jesus is the last truly tolerant place in America. Like, we are truly a place where people can dialogue and agree to disagree. I mean, that's wonderful. One of my favorite things about the last year, and I saw this up in Hebron, was a bunch of Hebron politicians published this flyer together, picture of Democrats and Republicans saying, we work together and we care for one another. And I just thought, man, how cool is that? Like, that's great. You know, this is our community. That's wonderful. But in the rest of the world right now, in the hindsight of 2020, I think we've been exposed to this new form of extremism. And again, I'm not trying to pick out Democrats or Republicans. I'm talking farther left and farther right, much farther. We've been exposed to these, what I would call religious political zealots. Politics has become a new religion for many people. Instead of Jesus being our Lord and Savior, instead of God being our Redeemer and our answer, politics has become our Lord and Savior for so many people. I still remember when it crystallized, I shared this story before, but talking with my aunt in the middle of the summer, she said, you know, the same love that you have for Jesus and the hope that you have for Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that's what I have for the Democratic Party. And it kind of crystallized with me. I mean, she was, you know, in a lot of ways holding our relationship hostage. If you say the wrong thing, you know, I'm gonna cut you off and whatever. And it's just, it was hard, but I realized, man, Jesus teaches us that we're saved by grace through faith. We didn't earn it. And so we were able to give grace to each other. And that's something that's unique about the Christian movement. The Christian movement has been uniquely tolerant. It's created these, you know, different societies that can thrive together, that can lay down their lives for each other. I mean, this is how Japan and the United States were essentially able to coexist because of the culture in America being so tolerant and compassionate. I mean, kind of amazing. But when you bring in this new religion, it's very much good versus evil. So if you disagree with me, you're less than human. And Christians stood at the social gunpoint of a political religion, and some of you have felt it. It's like, submit to me or you're a bigot. Oh, submit to me or you're unpatriotic and you're treasonous. Submit to me or you're racist, and I'll see that you lose your job and get canceled. Raise your kids with this perspective or you're hateful, and I'm going to work to see that they get taken away from you. What do you do as a Christian? How do you respond in a situation like this? And I know some of you, you're new to Christ and you've kind of felt this tension. It's like, what do I do? Like, what do I do? Like, I love Jesus. I don't understand. And I think most of us try to ignore it. That's what we do. It's like, that happened. That was awkward. You know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to be nice. I'm just not going to read the news anymore. Life is so much better. And don't get me wrong. I think we have a little bit too much invested into the 24-hour news cycle. Like, a little bit too much, right? And I think that we could throttle that back a little bit. That's not bad. But I think ignoring it isn't, like, the problem of the religion of woke progressivism and socialism and fascism, it's not going to go away. And we can ignore it, just like the Russians did in 1914. But how many of us have had a child or a family member who has succumbed to the socialist evangelism on social media? All of a sudden, you know, you ignored it. You said, I'll just go away. And all of a sudden, your own child or your own family member has become a religious extremist. And you're talking with them, and it's like they're speaking in these extreme terms, and they're dehumanizing people they disagree with. And it's like, wait, how did this happen? We can't just ignore it. Now, others have responded not with nothing, but with hatred. And that's not good either. Romans 12, 21 says, don't let evil conquer you, but conquer evil by doing good. We don't fight evil with evil. We don't fight fire with fire, but we don't remain silent. We overcome evil by doing what is good. So a lot of us are like, okay, we live in this polarized society. Crazy stuff is happening, Pastor. Like, can you give me something practical? And I can. Three things that are good that we can do as Christians. I just want to spend a little bit of time equipping you. And the first thing is hard but easy. I want to challenge you to develop a courageous, informed faith. Emphasis on informed. You know, after I got held at gunpoint on that train platform, I've spent a lot of time preparing for what I would do if I was held at gunpoint again. And I've taken some steps and things and reasons and certifications. I'm not going to freeze up again. Like, I have a plan. Okay, that happened. I know what I'm going to do next time. I've also taken steps mentally to prepare for the next time my faith is held at social gunpoint. When all of this started, I was taken aback. The first time it was like, is this happening? Right? I mean, somebody early in this pandemic called me a person of white privilege. And I was like, do you have eyes? You know what I mean? Like, I'm not white. Like, I don't even understand. And then I thought, wait, I don't even understand. Like, there's obviously something behind this. Like, they've decided, and I want to know, I want to learn, right? Somebody called me a racist part of a racist and broken system. And instead of ignoring that, instead of getting mad, instead of calling them ridiculous, I said, man, I really want to understand what is fueling this new religion. Right? And, you know, so I got some books that were recommended to me by people I disagreed with. I read, you know, John Wayne Christianity. I read The New Jim Crow, and they were okay. But what I really did was I got engaged with intelligent, informed Christian thinkers that were able to present this from a Christian perspective. And my favorite is the Elisa Childers podcast. And she has so much great biblical content. Highly recommend episode number 72 in particular, pertinent to what we're talking about. But she speaks on progressive Christianity, racism, social justice. And specifically, she speaks on what I would call the gospel of this progressive movement called critical race theory. And if you don't understand what critical race theory is, if you don't understand what intersectionality is, you don't understand the core of what you're arguing against. And this is why you're frustrated. That's like the core of it. If you don't understand those words, you got to get informed. And I think so many of us, we have big hearts and big faith. We just don't understand what we're facing. So we sit there and it's like, this is just so weird. This is so confusing. But when I began to understand that, I was like, okay, now I understand what you believe. And I understand like how to interact. And socialism and wokeness and critical race theory and fascism, they are siren songs that sound really tempting. It really sounds tempting because it makes you right and it makes everyone else wrong. And it feels good. But I want to be clear. This is not politics. This is a religion. Throughout human history, when these religions have arisen, it is Christianity that pays the price. It is people who worship God that are killed. The people shouting at you, the social justice warriors on one side, the Proud Boys on the other side, it's all part of new religions that don't see Jesus as the hope of the world. It sees government reform and revolution as the hope of the world. And I think that we need to understand this. If you want to argue with these people who are really passionate, you got to understand that this is not a political argument. This is a religious argument. And there is a religious devotion to this. Because of this, I've decided ahead of time to prepare my heart, to prepare my mind, very, very critical. I prepared myself not to give my power away. So when people argue with me and they call me a bunch of names, which they do, that I feel, you know, those names are unfair and wrong and crazy, I'm not going to give my power away by getting angry. Okay, I'm going to stay calm and I'm going to disarm and deconstruct their faith and their argument. I'm not going to be silent. Second thing I want to challenge you to do is engage our kids with real conversations and allow them to ask questions. I don't want my kids' only perspective on the Bible to be stories of Noah's Ark and Jonah and the whale. And I think for so many of us, it's like, oh, they know the Bible. They're good. No, I want them to know what they believe, but I want them to know why they believe it. Okay, and there's a great book out, and you can engage with this. It's a really, really good book called Mama Bear Apologetics, Empowering Your Kids to Challenge Cultural Lies. I think it's really, really healthy. Pretty simple read. It's all about protecting and preparing your children by teaching them how to handle missionaries from the religion of woke socialism and I would say the allure of fascism. Those things, they're so tempting. There's so much clarity. Result in killing people, that's not good. But I want to teach my kids a response in a real and informed and loving way. I don't want to let my kids' questions be answered on the school bus first. I want to answer them for them first. I want to engage with them first. I want to challenge you to take the time to talk to them about hard topics of human sexuality, gender, racism, sin, salvation, service, and social justice. You know, my daughters are now 5 and 7, and I talk with them about my oldest two daughters. I talk to them about these topics all the time, and some of you might say that's early, but several years ago, I was at the Wheatfield Library, and one of my daughters pulled a book off the shelf, and it was a book about crayons. You know, it was about this blue crayon that had a pink inside, and the crayon was told by all his friends to draw a blue line, but he could only draw a pink line, and eventually, you know, he connected with a counselor crayon and a doctor crayon who kind of helped him change his outside wrapping. And I remember reading that, and I wasn't horrified. I just thought, okay, I need to engage my children about this, right? And a lot of times in my mind, I'm like, oh, they're not old enough and stop and you don't need to talk to them. I mean, it's 5 for crying out loud. I thought, you know what? Like, I want to talk to my kid about how to think regarding this. You know, obviously, there is another religion that does not hesitate to evangelize my children at 5 years old about this. We spend hundreds of dollars or hundreds of hours and thousands of dollars getting our kids a good baseball swing and a good basketball shot. What if we spent 10% of that time engaging and preparing them to love Jesus and defend their faith from the onslaught? That's why I like this book. I just want to have conversations with them. I'm not saying be mean. I'm not saying be angry. Teach your kids about what you think. Give them a biblical worldview. And the last thing I want to challenge us to do, and this is a big deal, is I want to challenge you to consider taking dominion. And that's a big, big word. But Genesis 1:26 talks about this idea. It says, then God said, let us make man and women in our image after our likeness, and let us have dominion over the fish of the sea and over all creation. Now, dominion is this concept that means leadership or sovereign authority over. And I believe that God made this world for human beings to take control and sovereign authority over, specifically Christians. And I think for most of Christian history, Christians have done a really good job taking dominion over the land. But I would say that in the last 30 to 40 years, Christians have sort of turned this incredible force that is the church into a fortress. Well, I'm just going to protect my kids and send them to, you know, Christian school and da 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 da. I'm going to protect them and only read Christian movies and Christian books and all this stuff. And I'm not saying that's necessarily bad, but we're not called to be a fortress. We're called to be a force. And I don't think we just need pastors. I think that we need Christians in every field, preaching the gospel of Jesus in every area. And I think what's happened, especially people over 40 and over, okay, calling you out right now. I think you just sit back clucking and rolling your eyes saying, oh, the world these days, you know. I feel so sorry for kids these days. You know, I mean, they're just growing up and the world is crazy, you know, and it's just, and I'm glad that I didn't, and I feel so bad, and the phones and the things and the reasons and the pressure, and it's just the world these days is so hard. And I look at you and I say, rise up, get after it, change it. We have come back from worse and we have what it takes in the name of Jesus to overcome this. And I think that Christians should run for school board and town council and county council, not with a Republican agenda or a Democrat agenda, but with a Christ for the world agenda. We were called and made to take dominion over this land. I love going to the DeMott Wheatfield Town Hall and reading the names of the great men and women that have gone before us to build what we have. Now long gone, you know, generations past, who took dominion over building a wonderful community that we now thrive in. And I look at people today, 40, 50, 60, 70 years old. I say, it's time for you to take dominion over this land. Instead of saying, well, I feel sorry for the kids these days, while you reap the blessing of the blood, sweat, and tears of the long gone generations who went before us, it's time for you to pick up that mantle. Young people today, if they won't, why don't you? Instead of sitting and saying, you know what, I want to golf, I'm partially retired right now, and you don't understand, and whatever, like, take leadership of this community and say, in the name of Jesus, we will take dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and the land, and we will reclaim it and rebuild it in the image of God. Let's build a community that we can thrive in. And I look at the hindsight of history, hospitals, orphanages, modern medicine, the Red Cross, the scientific method, the emancipation of slaves, our understanding of genetics, the reason we have vaccines, all of these fields arose one time in human history because of Christians taking dominion over these areas. I mean, you can look at it. It's a matter of historical fact. Even if you're an atheist, you can say, hey, wow, thank you, Jesus, for all of these incredible things that we have. His teaching, his ideology, his philosophy, his morality, his ethic that has given us all of this. It's because Christians took dominion over this land. And I want to say, I think it is our time to be steadfast and unwavering, saying in the name of Jesus, we refuse to lay down and watch the world burn. We will stand for Christ and his kingdom. And we will call people to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we will take dominion over the land. As we close, I want to ask you guys to stand. I think that 2020 was a real eye-opener for us. And in a lot of ways, it was a bad year. But I believe that for Christians, this will be a great awakening. This will be an enlightening year. For Christians everywhere, I believe it will be the year where we realized we can no longer be a fortress, we must be a force. And we will not go silently into the night. And we will not vanish without a fight. This is a year to get our fight back, to rise up, to fight for our faith, to fight for our children's faith, and to take dominion over the land. Because when I read the gospel, the last thing I read is that Jesus Christ wins in the end, and that the best is yet to come, and that nations will rise and fall, but the word of the Lord will stand forever. God's got this. As we close, I'd ask you to bow your heads and pray with me. God in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we commission everyone hearing the sound of this voice to take dominion over your creation, for your gospel, for your name's sake, and for your glory. We corporately choose to rise up. I know that we pray that you will heal this land, God, and I know you hear our prayers, and I believe that you want to do it through us. I ask that you would do it through us. We choose not just to pray, but we choose to take action. I ask that you would do a wonderful, restorative, healing work in this nation through the people of this community and this church. Thank you for all that you've given to us. Today, together, we choose with a steadfast, unwavering courage to rise up and to take dominion. In the name of Jesus, all God's people said amen and amen. Band's gonna lead us in a song. Let's sing together.